Books on Tape presents John by Cynthia Lennon, read by Rosalyn Landor, with a foreword written and read by Julian Lennon.
Growing up as John Lennon's son has been a rocky path. All my life I've had people coming up to me saying, "I loved your dad." I always have very mixed feelings when I hear this. I know that Dad was an idol to millions who grew up loving his music and his ideals. But to me, he wasn't a musician or a peace icon. He was the father I loved and who let me down in so many ways. After the age of 5, when my parents separated, I saw him only a handful of times. And when I did, he was often remote and intimidating. I grew up longing for more contact with him, but felt rejected and unimportant in his life. Dad was a great talent, a remarkable man who stood for peace and love in the world, but at the same time, he found it very hard to show any peace and love to his first family, my mother and me. In many accounts of Dad's life, we are either dismissed or at best treated as insignificant bit players in his life, which sadly is something that continues to this day. Yet Mum was his first real love, and she was with him for half his adult life, from art college to the genesis of the Beatles, to their overwhelming worldwide success. That's why I'm so happy that she's decided to write her side of the story. For far too long now, Mum has put up with being relegated to a puff of smoke in Dad's life, and that simply is not the truth. Now it's time to set the record straight. There's so much that has never been said, so many tales that have never been told. If there is to be a balanced picture of Dad's life, then Mum's side of the story is long overdue. I'm immensely proud of her. She's always been there for me. She was the one who kept it all together, taught me what matters in life, and stayed strong when our world was crumbling. While Dad was fast becoming one of the wealthiest men in his field, Mum and I had very little. And she was going out to work to support us. Mum has always acted with dignity, and I have her to thank for who I am. I love her honesty and her courage, and I know it's taken a great deal of both for her to write her story. That's why I offer her my full support and recommend this book to anyone who wants to know the truth, the real truth, about Dad's life.
Introduction. For 10 years, I shared my life with a man who was a huge figure in his lifetime and who has become a legend since his death. Through the years in which the Beatles came together and went on to delight and astound the world, I was with him, sharing the highs and lows of his public and private lives. Since John's death, I've watched shelves full of books come and go, most by people who never knew him and who painted a one-sided, flawed picture of him and of our relationship. Many consigned me to a brief walk-on part in John's life, notable only because we had a son. I was usually dismissed as the impressionable young girl who fell for him, then trapped him into marriage. That was a long way from the truth. I was at John's side throughout the most exciting, extraordinary, and eventful 10 years of his life. It was a time when he was at his creative best, a time when he was witty, passionate, honest, and open, when he loved his family and loved the Beatles, a time before drugs and fame led him toward the destruction of so much that he had valued. After my marriage to John fell apart, I tried to escape the world of celebrity and the Lennon label by going off to find my own life. I wanted security for our son, and a life that was real and purposeful, out of the limelight. Both my privacy and my dignity were important to me, so I preferred to let others do the talking. But somehow I was never able to escape completely. The public interest always caught up with me, and I was frequently sought out for various Beatles-related projects, interviews, or books. Far from fading, fascination with the Beatles, and John in particular, increased over the years. In the early days, I said no to most of the offers and requests I received, but in the end, I realized there was no escaping the Lennon legend, or that I had been a part of it. So occasionally, when the project was worthwhile, or I needed to earn a living, I said yes to the requests and opportunities that came my way. I even talked about my relationship with John a few times, which I had refused to do for several years after we split up. I wrote a book back in the 70s, and after John's death I helped out with a biography about him and gave a couple of magazine interviews. What I never did was tell the full and truthful story of my life with John. After our divorce, I was so desperately hurt, angry, and lost that the only way I could cope was to push my feelings to one side and try to detach myself from them. I succeeded so well that whenever I talked about John and our split, I sounded calm, rational, accepting, and even cheerful. "Oh, well, these things happen," was the approach I adopted. But of course, the pain of the breakup stayed with me, even though I buried it as deeply as I could. Now the time has come when I feel ready to tell the truth about John and me, our years together, and the years since his death. There is so much that I have never said, so many incidents I have never spoken of, and so many feelings I have never expressed. Great love on one hand, pain, torment, and humiliation on the other. Only I know what really happened between us, why we stayed together, why we parted, and the price I paid for having been John's wife. Why now? Because, having tried to live an ordinary life for so many years since John and I parted, I have come to realize that I will always be known as John's first wife, and because I also have a powerful story to tell, which is part of John's history. John was an extraordinary man. Our relationship has shaped much of my life. I have always loved him and never stopped grieving for him. That's why I want to tell the real story of the real John, the infuriating, lovable, sometimes cruel, funny, talented, and needy man who made such an impact on the world. John believed in the truth, and he would want nothing less. Chapter 1. One early December afternoon in 1980, my friend Angie and I were in the little bistro we ran in North Wales, putting up the Christmas decorations. It was a cold, dark afternoon, but the atmosphere inside was bright and warm. We'd opened a bottle of wine and were hanging baubles on the tree and festive pictures on the walls. Laughing, we pulled a cracker and the toy inside fell onto the floor. I bent to pick it up and shivered when I saw it was a small plastic gun. It seemed horribly out of place among the tinsel and paper chains. The next day I went to stay with my friend Moe Starkey in London. I couldn't really spare the time during the busy pre-Christmas season, but my lawyer had insisted I go to sign some legal papers, so I took the train, planning to return the following day. I left my husband and Angie to look after things in my absence. Angie was the ex-wife of Paul McCartney's brother Mike, and after her marriage broke up, she'd come to work for us, living in the small flat above the bistro. It was always good to see Mo. We'd been friends since 1962, when I was John's girlfriend, and she was the teenage fan who fell in love with Ringo at the Cavern. Ringo and Mo had married 18 months after us, and in the days when the Beatles were travelling all over the world, she and I had spent a lot of time together. Her oldest son Zach was 15, a year and a half younger than my son Julian, and the boys had always been playmates. When Mo and Ringo parted in 1974, she had been so heartbroken that she got on a motorbike and drove it straight into a brick wall, badly injuring herself. She had been in love with him since she was 15, and his public appearances with his new girlfriend, American actress Nancy Andrews, had devastated her. After the split, Mo, still only 27, had moved into a house in the London neighbourhood Maida Vale with her three children Zach, 8, Jason, 6, and Lee, 3. Because of the injuries she'd received in the motorbike accident, she had plastic surgery on her face and was delighted with the result, which she felt made her look better than she had before. Gradually, she'd begun to get over Ringo, and she had a brief fling with George Harrison before she began to see Isaac Tigrett, millionaire owner of the Hard Rock Cafe chain. The evening I arrived, Mo had her usual house full of people. Her mother, Flo, lived with her, as well as the children and their nanny. Mo always had an open house, and that evening some old friends of ours, Jill and Dale Newton, had joined us for dinner. The nanny had cooked a huge meal, and later, Jill and Dale, Maureen and I sat over a couple of bottles of wine and talked about old times. After a while, the conversation turned to the death of Mal Evans, the Beatles' former road manager. Mal had been a giant of a man, generous and soft-hearted. We'd known him since the early days when he'd worked for the post office and moonlighted as a bouncer at the Cavern Club. When the Beatles began to be successful, they took him on to work for them. Mal had been a faithful friend to the boys and was especially close to John. They got on incredibly well, and with the Beatles' other loyal roadie, Neil Aspinall, he had been on every tour, organizing, troubleshooting, protecting, and looking after them. When the Beatles broke up, Mal had been lost. He'd gone to live in Los Angeles, where he began drinking and taking drugs. It was there on January the 4th, 1976, that the police had been called by his girlfriend during a row. She claimed that Mal had pulled a gun on her, and when they burst into the apartment, the officers found Mal holding a gun. Apparently, he pointed it at them before they shot him. It was only after he died that they found the gun wasn't loaded. It was a tragic story, and we could only imagine that Mal had been under the influence of drugs. The Mal we knew could no more have shot someone than flown to the moon. Whatever the true story, his death had shocked us all, and that night, our talk around Mo's fireplace was of what a good man he had been and how awful his premature death was. To us, the idea of being shot was almost unimaginable. How could it have happened to such a good friend? After a while, I went to bed. I knew the others would carry on talking and drinking until the early hours, but I wanted a good night's sleep as I had to get up early in the morning to catch the train home. I was asleep in the spare room when screams woke me. It took me a few seconds to realize that they were Mo's. At that moment, she burst into my room. "Sin, John's been shot! Ringo's on the phone. He wants to talk to you." I don't remember getting out of bed and going down the stairs to the phone. But Ringo's words, the sound of his tearful voice cracking over the transatlantic line, is crystal clear. "Sin, I'm so sorry. John's dead." The shock engulfed me like a wave.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.